So, you know, obesity in this country is a huge issue. We have a lot of patients who have gastric bypasses, gastric lap bands, sleeve, gastrectomies, all sorts of different surgeries on their stomach. So just be aware of that, because that's going to change the anatomy, and the tube may go in a different direction than you think it's going to go. The most common ones, I think, are probably the Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, where they just have a little patch of stomach left, and then they connect it up, and then you're going to see the rumen is going to come anteriorly, and it's going to go straight down. It's just going to look different than it should. It's going to look strange to you. This is really the best picture I can show you. You know, spinal column here, diaphragm is coming across here, the GE junction is somewhere here, where the esophagus empties into the stomach. This is contrast pooling in the fundus. This is the gastric body. This is the gastric antrum. Now this segment filled with contrast right here is the gastric antrum kind of turning backwards, pointing posteriorly towards the spinal column. Remember, the first few portions, or the second and third portion of the duodenum comes like a C shape. You guys may not have been exposed to this yet, I'm not sure what you had in anatomy, but the duodenum goes backwards towards the spinal column, and then it goes retroperitoneal, behind the retroperitoneal structure, so very deep into the tissues of the abdomen. It goes along the right side here for a couple portions, and then it comes back anteriorly, wraps in front of the spine and the aorta, and then it kind of goes back posteriorly a little bit, and then the ligament of tritis is right here. It kind of holds up this segment right here. This is a ligament that you can't really see, but it kind of, this is the expected structure. I want to drill this into y'all's heads because you're going to see this a lot, and a lot of people aren't going to know what these things that I'm telling you are, but you will. C-loop. We call this the C-loop of the duodenum. There are four portions of the duodenum, first, second, third, and fourth. The second part is posterior. The ligament of tritis holds up the fourth part. You guys kind of just internalize that, like remember that picture. The pancreas sticks in here and it has, the pancreatic duct empties into this portion of the duodenum that's retroperitoneal. And that's how your pancreatic juices mix in. So you get all your churning action, all your enzymes in the stomach, food contents that are kind of bad or beaten up go through here. They meet with all the pancreatic digestive enzymes right here, and then you start having real good digestion coming through here, and then passing into the jejunum, and then you get further digestion. So that's how this all works. But remembering these anatomical landmarks is really important for understanding where the tube is when you have to place a post-pyloric tube. So, again, tube, you want it to be in the gastric body, but if you want it to be a post-pyloric tube, you're going to have to place the tube, push it, it's going to hit this greater curvature, it's going to bounce and ride along the wall here. Then the tube is going to be diverted up and backwards into the antrum through the pyloric sphincter. It's going to meet resistance at the pyloric sphincter because that sphincter is usually kind of taut, but if you put enough pressure and weight for peristalsis, it'll open eventually. The tube will push through, it'll push through, it'll go backwards, and then it'll come down. Once you've got a curve in it, it looks like it's going back and then back down, then you're probably in the small bowel. So from there, if you keep pushing, you should be able to push, it'll keep coming down, and then about right here is where people say, okay, we're gonna stop. These tubes are really hard to place. Usually they're placed under fluoroscopy if you can't get them in otherwise. They place a lot of these in kids, and you're going to see a lot of these. Order if you're going to see a lot of these placed. I'll show you some pictures here in a second. Although I show you this awesome anatomy, it's like, you know, seems pristine and perfect. Ligament of tritis is right here, remember that one? There are anatomical variants. Usually they're pathological though. In kids, one of the things that we try to rule out is malrotation. That's a really important thing to rule out in kids. And malrotation basically happens, I'm not going to get too much into the embryology and stuff, but or the embryology and development. But the small bowel and the large bowel are just like a very simple tube in embryology, and they, at a certain point during development, they come out of the stomach, they rotate around from that simple linear tube into a very convoluted structure, which eventually resembles the adult bowel, which is just a spaghetti, basically, right? And then they come back in, and then they're in their expected configuration where the small bowel is kind of all looped up, and then the colon kind of comes across, like all the pictures of colon anatomy that you've seen, okay? That's how it's supposed to work. In some kids, that process goes awry for whatever reason, and things do not rotate as expected, and so you have intermediate or completely not, you know, non-rotated bowel, and that's called malrotation. The primary landmark we look at to know if there's malrotation or not is called the ligament of Treitz. So again, it holds this last segment up and separates the duodenum from the jejunum. And so that's, again, why I keep saying the name of that structure. You're going to hear it, especially in pediatrics, you'll hear that a lot, ligament of Treitz. Is the ligament good? Is the ligament okay? That's what they're testing for in the upper GI kid. Is the C-loop there? And is the ligament okay? Does this portion go retroperitoneal? If all that's intact, their chance of being malrotated is very low. They can have malrotated parts of their bowel distal to that, but that's what you're looking for. If they are malrotated, then you can see any of these different variants that you see over here looking just kind of, you don't go the way that they're supposed to go. And then that's when your postbilobed tube is going to go somewhere where it's unexpected. You can still use it, you know, you can still try to get it to where it's going to go. But if it goes somewhere and it starts going off to the right, instead of doing the C-loop thing, it's probably an anatomical variant, a pathologic variant usually. And that may actually maybe be able to diagnose a kid if they didn't know that they had it. All right, enteric tubes. So nasogastric tubes, again, go through the nasopharynx or gastric tubes or pharynx. Usually they terminate the gastric body. That's your goal. Again, you can insert tubes through whatever orifice into whatever part of the body you want to. So the names are just named for where they're, you know, inserted and where they're going. Nasogastric, nose, stomach. Orogastric, oral to stomach. Pretty simple, right? That's an NG or OG. And then other tubes, if they go on further post-pyloric tubes, that just means anything beyond the pylorus. That could be in the duodenum, could be a duodenal tube, or could be a jejunal tube. You can even, I suppose, go as far as the ileum, but you probably won't make it that far. Gastrostomy tube, this is a tube that is directly inserted to the stomach from the skin. This is your peg tube that you guys probably heard about. They make a site right on the skin, they access, they pull the stomach up right to the skin, and then they put a kind of securing device there, and they have a direct conduit. So they don't have to put, it's for long-term patients. A lot of older patients, patients with feeding difficulties, Alzheimer's, and you know, patients with dementia, or patients with Parkinson's, you know, patients who just can't eat, then they're gonna get a peg tube at a certain point. Or if they don't want to eat for some reason. And then a jejunostomy tube is a direct post-pyloric tube, basically. It's the same thing as like a G-tube or a PEG tube, except it's a direct conduit where they pull the small bowel up to the skin instead of the stomach. And then the other way you can do it is you can have a tube go in the stomach and then go post-pyloric from there instead of accessing that directly. These are just more kits, just fancy pictures, I guess, to show you that, you know, how you dilate these sites if you're trying to make a PEG tube. This is what NG tube looks like. It's got centimeter markers on it, so you can measure how many centimeters you've inserted it. So if I make a measurement of like, you know, oh, this should be retracted 15 centimeters, you just count on the tube. These, you don't have to worry so much about sterility because it's going to the oral cavity GI tract, and it's not going into a vessel. So you can usually just push these tubes further back and we don't have to worry about that. All right, so why do we put enteric tubes in? We want to feed patients through them, we can give medicines through them, we can suction through them, depending on how many lumens, if there's a suction hooked up to it, we can drain stuff through them. And then we also, you know, in fluoroscopy and radiology, we can put contrast through them to see where the tube is. Because if contrast comes out the other end of the tube, then it shows us, it highlights the structure that it's in. It's pretty easy. And so this is enteric tube right here. You can see the diaphragm here, the heart up here. This enteric tube is poly in a gastric body. That's what I would call it. I point here at this little arrow, there's a little gap here that you probably can't see because the picture's not large enough. But there's a little gap in the metal stripe. There's a radio opaque or a stripe basically that we can see in the radiograph, and that's why we can see the tube well. And there's a gap in that stripe about right here. That is a side port, and I think it's used for suction. I'm not 100% sure, but that side port, typically you want it to be also beyond the GE junction. Because if it is used for suction, you don't want sucking stuff up in the esophagus. So I'd usually mention that in my reports. Let's see. This one, what do you guys think is going on here? This is a weighted enteric tube, so it's got a bunch of weights stacked in it. But clearly something is going awry here. What do you guys think is this tube is? Any ideas? So, yeah, so there's a couple things. It could have perforated the esophagus, which may be the case in this one. It could have, this tube could have entered like a large hiatal hernia. It could still be inside the hernia, but usually you'll see the silhouette of the hernia. So I feel like this one's probably perforated too. Yeah, side ports to lumen, weighted. So weighted ones, more of these eponyms or historical names, Dabach tubes, and then Mickey, you guys have heard like Mickey buttons and stuff, post-pulmonary tubes, just other names and stuff. And then ostomy or percutaneous. If you have an ostomy, it's like small bowel, you can catheterize that and you can use that as like an enteric tube as well. This is a GJ tube. So this is like a big tube, except instead of being super short and stopping the stomach, it goes post-pyloric into the jejunum. And so that's what a GJ tube is. Okay, so each type of tube, orogastric tube, you can see it follows a straight course, does not go into a bronchus. So the trachea is a lucent structure right here. See how it's got air in it? And then the carina is the bifurcation point of the trachea where it bifurcates into the left and right main stem bronchus. And you can see those usually if you kind of squint. You gotta kind of look close. I think the carina here is about right here. It's pretty hard to tell. I can see this left main stem bronchus right here. And so the carina is probably about right here. So if you have a tube that's going this way or this way, then that's an endobronchial tube, as bad. And then it's not coiled up in the chest, so it hasn't hit the esophagus, started coiling up. And then it's below the diaphragm. This one is in the fundus. See how it's at the top of the stomach? The gastric bubble's right there. Let's see. Avoid the lungs, avoid the nasopharynx. Sometimes these tubes can come up into the nasopharynx, and they may even come out the patient's nose if they, so careful. If it's supposed to be in the stomach, then if it curls back around and goes backwards, that's probably pylorus, you don't want it there. And then just order an upper abdominal x-ray, and if you don't see it on that, then order a chest radiograph, because it's somewhere in the chest or in the neck. Okay. NG tubes, same thing, just inserted from the nose. Orojejunal tube inserted from the mouth goes to the jejunum. So this is a post-pyloric tube. It's going to be longer, or you're going to insert it further. Weighted tubes can help you place stuff easier because a lot of times these tubes just don't want to go all the way there. And you keep trying to place them further and further, and they keep coiling up. And the weighted tube gives you gravity, but it also you can use the patient's peristalsis. If you just wait, sometimes that tube will migrate through and it'll settle where you want it to be. So this one's coming down, it's going through here. It's going across the gastric body, gastric antrum, and then it kind of goes a little bit backwards here. This is pylorus, and then it's retroperitoneal duodenum. And then this is going to be in the second or third portion of duodenum. See how it comes right back around here by the anatomy. This one, where do you guys think that one is?
The lung?
Right main stem bronchus, yeah, it's going kind of deep into one of the bronchioles in the lung. That's not good. You don't want to be, you can kind of collapse along that way. It kind of gets occluded. And if you feed through that, you're going to instantly cause pneumonia. That's not good. Okay, so So upper abdominal x-ray for those tubes. Nasojejunal, just same thing, just insert it from the nose. Same thing. Egg tubes, this is what I was explaining earlier, anchored right to the stomach. This is what it looks like on a radiograph. It's got the outside and then the inside kind of anchors. There may be a balloon in there too.
Okay, sorry. That ring?
Yeah, that's a balloon right there. It's got air inside of it. GJ tube. Let's see. So this one. Okay, so here's the little ring where it's inserted in the skin. It goes through duodenum here. It's called postpalatal, wraps around, and it's, this one's going really far, but the point is it goes beyond the stomach postpalatal. Let's see, this one is, let's see, GJ tube. Avoid going up the esophagus, obviously, and order abdominal x-ray. If you are really not sure where one of these deep tubes is, just call radiology. You can order an upper GI or just order like a one. Specify that you just want to check the tube placement. They'll put some contrast to the tube. They'll see if it lights up the stomach or if it lights up the small bowel. It's pretty easy to distinguish those two structures because they look different when there's contrast in the stomach and the small bowel. So this one just shows there's contrast in the small bowel here. You can see all this contrast in the small bowel. So these help you with figure out where your tooth is. J tube, again, you pull the bowel up against the skin instead of the stomach, and you just insert the tube directly. Avoid going up the other way towards the stomach. You want it to go down distally. And then, again, order abdominal x-ray confirm under fluoroscopy. All right, just some random things that you may see on chest film. Esophageal temperature probes, maybe like a straight line looking thing that can confuse you for an enteric tube. But if they don't have an enteric tube in, then that's maybe a temperature probe. And then there's pH probes as well. This is a pH probe. It's got all these kind of sensors along the tube. Actually, those are impedance sensors. I'm not really sure what those are for, but it looks different from other tubes. An allometry catheter is to test the motility of certain parts of bowel. And these can be inserted to any part of the bowel to see how well the motility is working. They look distinct. There's markers all over the tube. Complications of enteric tubes, malposition. There's a big old pneumonia right there from inserting into the right main stem bronchus. And then perforation. You can perforate stuff with these tubes too. This is a big leak. We tested. You can see it going through the esophagus, the contrast. You can see it going through the, into the lower esophageal. This is actually a little hiatal hernia here, into the stomach. This is the first part of the stomach. And then what's all this? That's not supposed to be there. That's a big leak from perforation into the mediastinum. If these go unnoticed, they can cause infections, abscesses, and make the patient very sick. Pneumothorax, if you can, stick a tube here, it can cause pneumothorax, but it just is easily. Pneumonia, we talked about that. All right, tracheal tubes. This is pretty straightforward and simple. Basic anatomy of the trachea, it splits into two mainstem bronchi and then smaller segments thereafter. The most common place to malposition a tube or for patients to aspirate is going to be the right lower lobe into this right bronchus here because it's the most, it's the straightest bronchus that goes down. So it's just the path of least resistance for a lot of things. And so the right lower lobe pneumonia and stuff just keep an eye out for those. Or if you see something diagnosed as a right lower lobe pneumonia, think maybe that could be an aspiration. Again, type of glass is here. In this case, we want the upper glass to stay wide open when we put the tracheal tube in. A lot of these patients are unconscious. Most of them are unconscious. But some of them aren't. Some of them, they're anaphylactic or something like that. And then this is a tracheostomy, more of a longer term thing. Just remember with these tubes, you can cause a lot of damage. So make sure your technique, if you're putting these in, is pretty good because the vocal cords are right there. And one of the most common things that can happen is vocal cord injury requiring like months, years of therapy after an endotracheal intubation. So just be aware of that. You want to be gentle, careful. Emergent situations are emergent situations. So if you have to push them fast, you do what you got to do. But be aware of that. Tracheal intubation. Okay, so this is just an ET-tube. We call it ET-tube, endotracheal tube. Where do you want the tube? Remember we talked about the carina. It's difficult to see it, but if you look at enough chest films, you're going to see that. Just look for the bronchus, and then you can kind of trace it back to where the trachea is, and that's the carina. You want these tubes to be about 2 centimeters from the carina in adults. In kids, you know, kids are smaller, so it's going to be a little bit closer, maybe a centimeter. But that's where you want to target the carina. And so if you see it deviating off to the right or the left, or it's just way short of the carina, may not be getting adequate ventilation, that's your target. Avoid putting it into the esophagus. That can result in bad situation if you put it in the esophagus. Because if it's an emergent patient, then you're not giving any airway support to them while it's in the esophagus. So recognize that quickly and get it back into the right tube. Order a 1-view chest x-ray, you can see it at the top. You can also see tracheostomies. These usually target the mid-trachea. Same thing, it's harder to stick these deeper because they're usually a pretty fixed length. So. Complications of intubation, endobronchial intubation. This is a serious thing too. So you know, we talked about esophageal intubation. This can result in death if you know, if it's an emergent patient who's already dying. They can get hypoxemic if it's in the wrong spot. Just remember that. But if it's in, if you put a tube into a bronchus and you don't figure it out quick, it can result in lung collapse of the other lung because you're only going to be ventilating the lung where the tube is, and the other lung can collapse. And what that results in is the whole mediastinum is going to shift towards that collapsed lung, and then that collapse, anytime you have mediastinum shifting, puts a lot of pressure on the heart. The heart won't be able to contract fully, and that can result in cardiac tamponade, which can kill the patient. So sorry to the, you know, bear, you know, it's kind of grim, but you know, careful. Tracheal perforation, you can definitely, if you put that tube in fast enough, you can perforate the walls of the trachea. And then you're going to get a chest x-ray that looks like this, where there's air everywhere. Do you guys appreciate this air that's just kind of all throughout the soft tissues here? See all the air in the mediastinum? All right. And then vocal cord trauma like we talked about. All right, last section is drainage catheters. So you guys, depending on what sort of specialties you guys go into, you may be placing a lot of drainage catheters, doing things like thoracentesis, things like paracentesis, those sorts of things, and treating pneumothorax. So where do you want to put a tube that's draining air or fluid from a lung? Here's some of the basic anatomy. So you got, you know, your lungs here, you have the pleura. You've got a parietal pleura, which is, parietal means wall, so you have the pleura against the chest wall. And then you have the visceral pleura, which is the, visceral means organ, so pleura that's against the organ, the lung. And you want to put your catheter in that space, the pleural space, right? Usually it's not going to be an issue because you're going to be sticking a catheter into an open cavity which has air or fluid in it. There's not much reason to stick a catheter if there is no collection of fluid or air. So it's usually going to be easy, usually. You want to target the right space, which I'm not, you know, we're not going to go over the whole procedure, but where do you want the catheter to go? Well, usually, for patient comfort, we put the catheters into the upper anterior chest. It's kind of uncomfortable to be laying on a catheter. So unless you really have to, try not to put them back. Try to put them somewhere on the, usually maybe like the right upper chest, and or right mid or upper chest. And, you know, different, you know, faculty differ on like which ribs between they want to, you know, there's certain targets for which ribs you go between. Just remember the bottoms of ribs have veins, arteries, and nerves, so stay on top of ribs if you're going to do things. Where do you want the catheter tip to go? You want it to go into the collection. That's really simple. You want the tubes, there's a lot of little drainage holes on the sides of the tubes. You want those to have maximal surface area to that collection, and you want it to be dead center wherever that is. If you have a mobile fluid collection or air collection, that's not loculated. When I say loculated, That means that that collection is kind of walled off. It's pretty, it's not going to move around. If you have a loculated collection, just make sure the tube is in the collection. But if you have, that's usually not the case. Usually it's free moving fluid or air. Excuse me, I got it. Or air, I think it was that Red Bull that I had, like, or air that's, air, it's just gravity. So air is going to rise and fluid is going to fall to the bottom. So you have to think about how to position that patient. You're going to be rolling that patient around in certain ways, or telling them, you know, they're going to be staying in the hospital for, you know, maybe a day or two at least. And so you'll say, you know, lean up on your left side or your right side, depending on where you want the air or the fluid to accumulate. And you want that to be right where your catheter is. So usually you kind of get one shot at this and you're like, cross your fingers, did I get it where I want it to go? Because I don't want to put the patient through the agony of taking it out, put another tube in. It's really uncomfortable. And so you try to get an angle with your tube for, if you have a pneumothorax, the air is usually going to rise. You're usually going to be setting up in bed a little bit because of that. And so you want that catheter to deflect against the lung, the visceral pleura, and go up. So you want it to be in the apex, usually. It's usually the one. So to get that to happen, you kind of have to angle your skin side to where you're aiming up, and then try to push the tube up and just kind of imagine as you're pushing the tube that it's going up. And then you get your chest x-ray and you see, is it going where I want it to? Or did it flop against some structure and flip down? They flip down a lot. It's hard to get them. And then if you have a pleural effusion, you may want them to be low. You may want it at the base of the lung, or you may want the patient to lean on their left side and put it against the left side chest wall. Maybe you're going to put that catheter a little lower. And just hit the fluid or air collection, you'll be good. Just some anatomical landmarks. Your tubes can go into the fissures and kind of get stuck in the fissure, and they'll be sucking things, and it'll be sucking the two parts of the lung together, and once inside the fissure, maybe none of your fluid or air is going to be there. That may need it to be repositioned. The catheter can also go under the medial edges of the lungs, like the lingula, and be stuck against the heart. A lot of times you get a chest film, and you'll be like, oh my God, is that tube in the heart? Very rare that the tube's going to be in the heart, even if it looks like it's in the heart. It's probably folding around some of these medial lung structures and laying against the heart on the front side or back side or something like that. And it looks like it's in the heart, but if it were in the heart, you would know it for sure. All right. UE is a temporary catheter use, usually in emergencies, or if we have we want to just get quick access. It's just a quick puncture the site, and you get access to a cavity, pretty slow flow rates. We use these if we have like a big pneumothorax that's like, you know, getting larger pretty quickly. We'll throw one of these in temporarily, we'll hook it up and we'll start sucking air out. You can use these to suck fluid out. They're just pretty low flow rate. But usually what we do is we'll put like a larger catheter, like a pigtail catheter in. And the pigtail catheter, it just looks like a little curly tube underneath. So it's straight initially, or at least we straighten it out when we put it in. And it's got a little thread inside, like a sewing thread. And when we pull that, it tightens up the loop, basically. And it makes it come together while it's inside the cavity. And it's got a bunch of drainage holes that run along the edge of that loop. So it's really good at draining large fluid collections. And for pneumothorax, too. These are the types that we usually actually place for chest tubes. This differs from institution to institution, whether we can use straight tubes, pigtails, or whatever. Again, amapically, and then usually if we put a chest tube in for a pneumothorax happens anytime you puncture a lung, be it from, tension pneumothorax, gunshot wound, whatever, or we do it most of the time, lung biopsies for people who have a lung lesion, lung cancer. Sometimes people with emphysema get spontaneous pneumothorax. They're going to get one of these tubes. They're going to be in the hospital for a couple days. We hook them up to suction, and then we just, you'll see, I'm going to show you a little box. This is the box that they hook up. You may have seen this before if you guys haven't done any clinicals yet. Not yet, okay. So you'll see these boxes in patient rooms. There's a this little water level right here, and you'll see bubbles coming out of this. This is hooked up to their chest tube. And when the bubbles are coming out, that means that there's air coming out. So This is the box that you use to kind of manage the tube on the floor, make sure it's doing what it needs to do. All right, hook to suction, and then so, then once, so, you know, you kind of wean the patients off this, once you kind of drain that pneumothorax away, then you will kind of transition them off of that. You don't just want to yank the tube out and be like, all right, see you later. You want to transition them, so you want to make sure that they are inflating their lung by themselves. So you switch them to water seal, and we usually don't clamp the tube, we just switch to water seal. And then their lung, if it stays tacked up against the chest wall, then you're good. If it comes down again and we have to go back, sometimes patients stay in there for a week or more depending on if they've got bad emphysema. If it's not working, reposition it. You can order a one or two view chest x-ray. A two view is going to show you anterior or posterior. If it is, especially if it's like a loculated collection in the front anterior of the chest, then you want to get the lateral view to make sure it's not in the back of the chest. And you can do decubitus film too. Decubitus just means that they're laying on their side. And so decubitus film, you can get if you want certain fluid or air to go in a certain direction. Thoracic drains, these are going to be larger drains. Usually these are going to be post-surgical drains. They look like this, just a really large bore drain. These are usually placed in the OR for, you know, if someone's had like a big procedure, like a CABG, like a big heart bypass, and they'll put a bunch of drains in, maybe in the mediastinum to drain fluid, post-surgical hematomas, and then, you know, seromas, which is serous fluid that accumulates. And if there's no output, then they need to be repositioned. So just watch your drain outputs. This is what the pigtail catheter looks like when it's outside the body. And then going into abdominal stuff, you can use a pigtail for abdominal stuff as well. You can see the same pigtail drain as in the abdomen here. And this one is actually maybe in the frostomy, so this one may actually be in a kidney somewhere. I see some contrast here. And you can just order an abdominal x-ray to evaluate that. You can also inject contrast, or you can call radiology and see if they can put some contrast in, and then they can verify that it is in the right abscess cavity, make sure that the contrast isn't going the wrong direction. And then they'll take another film and see that. This is a ureteral stent, just one, so you know what that looks like. It's going from the right renal pelvis, the kidney, through the right ureter into the bladder. So you may see these kind of tubes. If patients have like hydronephrosis, their kidney's just holding so much water, or they have pyelonephritis, infected kidney, they may put one of these in to relieve that obstruction. JP drains are just another eponym or, you know, historical name, Jackson Pratt drain. These are, you'll see these patients coming out of the OR with these, or patients who have big wounds will have JP drains. They've got a little bulbous catheter on the end. You watch the output, you can see the output directly. You're going to order an abdominal x-ray or KEB to look at those, and then you can also inject contrast into those. And larger drains, just like those large drains I showed you in the chest, like this drain, you can also use those in the abdomen too if they've got some really bad post-surgical or abscesses in the abdomen. And those drains look like this. They're really big drains, and then they can hook up to pretty much like a Foley bag. Just weird things that you may encounter, a peritoneal dialysis catheter. Some patients, instead of doing normal dialysis through like a fistula or through like a tunnel blow action like that, they will just basically irrigate through their peritoneal cavity, and then they will irrigate fluid in and out, and they'll do dialysis that way. That's kind of something that some patients do if they're not in like complete renal failure, like not all the way to where they need like, you know, vascular dialysis. So what those catheters look like, they look like a tube that is coming from the skin and it's coiled in the pelvis. It'll always be like a big coil in the pelvis. And then ventricular shunts, a lot of people with hydrocephalus, you know, a lot of can be pediatric patients or older patients usually, they'll have a catheter that goes into their ventricles in their brain and it's tunneled through the skin all the way to their abdomen, and it's coiled up in their abdomen. This is what it looks like. You can kind of barely see it here. This one is like someone drew a line on this so you can clearly see it. But this is what it'll look like on a real radiograph. You see the catheter going all the way down the abdomen and coiling in the pelvis somewhere. All right, all these different types of drains, the purpose of these is just to drain or shunt fluid in different directions. They can be put in the wrong place. They can have poor output. You can have trauma or perforation with these tubes just like any others. You can get pneumothorax with these tubes. You know, if you have a pleural effusion and then you put a synthesis catheter in, like a pigtail, you can puncture the lung while you're inserting it, and you can get air coming out instead of just pleural fluid. So the catheters can fracture. Here's a fracture of a VP shunt, ventricular peritoneal shunt. They can get an infection or peritonitis. That's a big one. So peritonitis is bad. That's another indication for getting a paracentesis, get fluid out, send it for culture, and for tests. And if it's infected, you need to, you know, treat that because they can get abscesses everywhere in their abdomen after this. Pretty much it. There's two more quick things I just wanted to tell you about looking at radiographs. So when you look at a chest radiograph, let's just say this one right here. A lot of times, or an abdominal radiograph, the film is going to look super bright and you can't see anything. And you see a tube coming down here, but you just kind of lose it. It just kind of fades away. And you're like, I just can't see the tip of the tube. Should we repeat the x-ray? Well, usually that happens if the film is underpenetrated. They didn't use enough x-ray energy to make it through the patient's tissues. So typically it's going to be like a larger patient who's got like a lot of like abdominal fat or fat on the chest, and the beam just can't penetrate through at the normal x-ray dose. So oftentimes you'll have to tell the tech it's an underpenetrated film, and maybe they can crank the KV or the energy up, and they can penetrate through and see. It's better than just taking the catheter out and trying again. Like, why would you want to do that if it's just a radiology issue, right? And then, let's see, oh yeah. And then leads that can confuse you for lines and tubes. Cardiac leads, number one offender. If you get a chest x-ray and you see just lines everywhere and you're just like, there's no way I'm not going to figure this out. Stare at it for a while. Over time, your mind starts to subtract out these lead wires. You can see that they're, you know, they have certain attachment points to the skin. If you look at enough, you'll start to subtract those out and you won't even barely see them anymore. You'll be seeing the enteric tube coming to where you think it's going to be. You'll see those vascular tubes coming from the IHAs, and you'll subtract those out. So, you know, don't be afraid of like a film that's got tons of tubes on it and just be like, I'm called radiology. You can figure it out. Don't hesitate to call if you have questions. I don't work here, but I'm just saying, you know, radiologists usually nice people. They're not like surgeons, so. All right, that's all I got. Any questions?
I imagine you guys have pretty expensive monitors. Do you use screen protectors for this?
That's a good question. So I actually had a big screen protector fiasco. We just got a new TV in our resident library. So we in the IR suites, for like the neuro IR suites, they have like, it's probably like that side. I don't know. Do you have screen protectors on that?
No.
I don't imagine y'all are like playing basketball here or something. But we have one in there because like one of our IR attendings just pushes stuff and just shoves stuff. And it's like, give me that, and just is a danger to everyone except the patient. We tried getting the screen protector on the TV in the library, and it like glared every single light in the background. We had to take it back, and then we tried to ship it back, and they told us it was going to cost $800 to ship it back because it was like too large to ship the traditional way. So it didn't work out. We just took it off. But otherwise, the little monitors where we actually have our read stations, no, we don't need these screen protectors.
One of the residents you work with put me up to that question.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, to ask me that?
Yeah.
I was like, that seems way too, like, that's too soon. Who was it? Was it Gazi?
Vishal.
Vishal, okay.